sometimes the and so it's safer to just all right, still got 1 minute. Good morning. Welcome to Carson Valley United Methodist Church. It is, as always, a wonderful day to worship our Lord. Let's see, the regular announcements I try to make every Sunday. First, let me introduce myself. I'm Tony Hafner. I'm blessed to be the pastor here. I'm glad that you are here with us. Yellow cards. Hopefully, you got a yellow card along with your program this morning. And the yellow card is for attendance. That's really, really important if you are our guest today, because it gives me a way to get back in touch with you and let you know that I'm glad you're here. White cards. There are white cards like this, hopefully on the back of the pew in front of you. And those are for sharing prayer requests or praises. If you have a prayer request or a praise that I could read from that card a little bit later on in the worship service, please fill that out now. And then during the birthday bank time, you'll recognize that later on in the worship service, you could bring it up and hand it to me. Okay, I think those are all the announcements. Let's begin our worship service this morning with our opening hymn. It is Come Christians Join to Sing. It's an old favorite. It's number 158 in the big hymnal. The words will be on the screen. I invite you to stand as you feel comfortable while we sing.
Thank you. morning. Please join me in prayer. Father God, I'm sorry, I have to get my glasses on. I can't see. This is new to me for reading glasses. Sorry. Father God, we are honored and humbled to have you among us today. Please open our minds and hearts to your word and lead us in your way. Help us to be more fully know you and know who you have created us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, please be seated. It's time now for our children's time. So if you are, if you're watching from at home, gather the kids around the screen. Miss Nancy's here with Pepper, her kitty cat.
Goodness, Pepper, what have you got there? Oh, sorry. Thanks. It's my treasure. Looks like a bag full of yarn, doesn't it? Yeah, just bag full of yarn. Not just any bag full of yarn. It's my bag full of yarn. Okay, so what do you do with it? I keep it. I collect it, I keep it. You don't knit or crochet with it? Heavens, no. And I wouldn't have it anymore. I wouldn't have enough. Well, how do you know when you have enough? Well, that is a problem. It does look like I need a bigger bag. Or maybe not. Maybe you could, I don't know, share it or something. Oh, no. I take it with me everywhere because if I leave it at home, somebody might take it. Your cat, Scoogie, is known for taking balls of yarn and running them around the house. Okay, but you know, you could let somebody else use that. Have you ever thought about that? No. Why would I do that? I mean, I want to keep having it so that I can be known as the rich cat with all the yarn, and so I have it for my future. And what will you do with it in your future? What do you mean? I'll have it. I'll just have it. Okay. Pepper, maybe we need to think about this. What does the Bible say that God wants us to do? Oh, to love our neighbors. Okay. So, you know, I know a lot of people who knit and crochet, and they make prayer shawls for people who need comfort, and they make hats and blankets for people who need them, and they use yarn for that. Yeah. So, well, maybe if you shared your yarn with those people, then you could be showing your love for others. Oh. Huh. But I wouldn't be the rich cat anymore, I guess, but I would be rich toward God, because that's what God wants, huh? That's right, Pepper. So you're going to share your yarn now? Okay, that's good. And you don't have to give it all away. You know, just be generous. Okay, I can do that. Let's pray. Loving God, you are so generous to us. Help us to be generous to others and to show them your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen.
All right.
Get your yarn. There you go.
Thanks, Nancy. Thanks, Pepper.
Uh-huh.
All right. Really enthusiastic about giving, wasn't Pepper? Okay. I like that. Okay. Well, it's time now for the birthday bank. I mentioned that in the announcement time. Let's see. The birthday bank is a great way to celebrate special events in our lives with a small donation that goes into this little bank that accumulates in a separate fund in the church that we use to support children's programs and projects around the world and in our community. So, what celebrations do we have today?
Yesterday we got to celebrate my father's 92nd birthday and my sister's not as much birthday.
All right. Well, happy birthdays to them. Oh, thank you.
We're celebrating our 52nd anniversary tomorrow.
All right. Happy anniversary. All right.
Yesterday, Alpine Kids went to the pack station, and look, pack station, we only had 25. There was a large gathering of Native Americans at the meat bay, so we didn't have any of those them to participate with us. We all had a wonderful time, good food, hay rides, horseback riding. And I have to tell you, Tony was going to leave at 1:30, get there in time for lunch, and be gone by 1:30. Well, he didn't leave till 6 o'clock or so, and Laura was leaving at 4, and she didn't leave until Tony left, so we all
right. Had a great time. It was a lot of fun, very relaxing. Spent some time in a hammock and my special napping chair. It was a very productive day. That's right. Melissa's birthday. All right, happy birthday to Melissa. All right. Thanks, Joan. Okay, well, it's time now for the giving of our tithes and our gifts. And as I pretty much say every Sunday, a reminder that we're not passing the basket, but we do have that time set aside in our worship service to offer a gift of our talents. And for that, Christy is going to bless us with her offertory this morning.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever more. Bless my Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name, I'll worship your holy name.
Please stand if you're able and join me in prayer. God Almighty, thank you. We are able to honor you with both tithes and actions. You provide us with all we need, and we are eternally thankful. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
All right. And please be seated once again. We stand and sit a lot, don't we? I remind everybody every once in a while that we stand as a symbol in a liturgical worship service. We stand as a symbol of our coming together, as our uniting as one. And so that's why we do that at special times in the worship service. I'm going to sit right now just to be in solidarity with you. There we go. All right. I like that. Okay. Well, as I mentioned before, what I will do is read the prayers, and after I've read those, we'll lift our voices together, saying, Lord, hear our prayers. After I have read the praises, we'll likewise join our voices together, this time saying, we thank you, Lord. As we enter into this time of prayer, Christy, would you help us quiet our hearts and minds, please? Sue Hanley lifts up prayers for Jim Campstra. He is in the hospital at Carson Tahoe and is having some tests done and hopes to get out of there and into rehab. Also, prayers for Bob Pullman. Still feels ill, and I always pray for him to get feeling better. Prayers for the family and friends of JoJo Daughtry. She's been active in Alpine Kids, has been a teacher and a friend to many in Alpine County, and she passed away this past Friday. Martha lifts up Sylvia Smith. She's having a hip replacement on 8/1, that's tomorrow, okay? In prayer for Sylvia. Also, Martha lifts up Hannah Keels. She is in her second week of radiation. For Julie Hart, had mouth surgery and is having some physical therapy to help that to become a bit more successful. And also people in Mariposa, the Oak Fire has displaced many, and many have lost homes, so be in prayer for those. Tammy Shannon lifts up prayers for my husband Kevin, just diagnosed with diabetes. We're in prayer for Kevin. Tammy Shannon also lifts up prayers for everyone who knew Joe Daughtry. And she passed away very suddenly, unexpectedly, and blessings for those who mourn her. This is prayer request for travel mercies for the Harringtons as they return home to North Carolina this week. You'll be missed. It's been great to have you with us for the last few weeks, so. Vicki Kinneman lifts up prayers for her third cousin and the family who lost their home in the Oak Fire near Mariposa. They also lost the homestead home. So I guess the old family home got burned by the fire as well. Oh my goodness. Okay. Elaine Robertson lifts up prayers for my 91-year-old father, John Gillis. John has COVID, and he hasn't eaten in the past week, so we're going to be in prayer for John, that the Lord will strengthen him and give him his appetite back and get him back on the road to recovery. Edie and Lynn lift up more prayers for those who are missing Joe Daughtry. Their family and hundreds of friends and the several hundred children that she helped to raise. All right, these are our prayers. Let's lift them up to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. I have just a couple of praises this morning. I'm lifting up a praise for the great time we had at the Antelope Pack Station with the Alpine Kids. It's great. Gosh, what, I'd never been there before. It's a very beautiful place. Even with the encroaching burn scar that is there from, I guess, the Slink Fire, I believe they said it was. But still, it's a beautiful place and very accommodating, very hospitable people that run the place. So, also, prayers for Thanksgiving, praise for the promise of rain today. All right. Kind of smell it on the way in. It's going, yeah, it's getting close. Let's lift up these praises to the Lord. We thank you, Lord. I'm going to pause for a moment of silent prayer. And in the silence, as always, I encourage each of us to open our hearts to God and lift up unspoken prayer concerns or praises. Mighty God, we thank you for the life that you have given us and just the blessing of the people that we have lived this life with, that we have encountered and have touched our lives. We thank you for the gifts that you've allowed us to give them, and we thank you for that which we have received from them. We thank you most of all, Father in heaven, for the gifts that you continue to give to each of us. For all of this, we give you praise and thanks. We pray, Lord, that your joy might now be added to each of ours, that our joy might be complete. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to stand together as we join each other and join with the Lord in reciting the prayer which Jesus knew his disciples would be recognized by. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. All right, please be seated once again today. Today we have another recording of our chancel choir that was created back when we were not able to gather together because of COVID. But it's a really great anthem, and thanks to those who participated in this in isolation, and thanks especially to our choir director, our music director, Tammy Owens, for as she was able to assemble this and put it together.
Thank you.
You should hear them when they get together.
Please stand. Today we're hearing from Luke 12, verses 13 through 21, the parable of the rich fool. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, "What should I do, for I have no place to store my crops?" Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Be seated once again. All right, this is a classic Bible story. It's a classic parable of Jesus. One of the well known parables of Jesus. I think that we tend to oversimplify it when we just take it as a snippet of Scripture and we don't really search what comes before and what comes after to give it a bit more meaning. It becomes then just simply a great vehicle for a sermon about giving till it hurts, you know? So I'm just going to say right now, just give till it hurts and we're done. Okay, no, that's not what this is about. All right. In Luke's gospel, Jesus is this champion of the common person. Luke's gospel is a wonderful place for us to look when we feel like we just don't fit in. You know, Jesus is this champion of the lowly and the oppressed in Luke's gospel. In Luke's gospel, Jesus is always contending with the elite, you know, and the establishment and that sort of thing. And it's no different here as we look at this parable. What comes before this parable is Jesus telling the Pharisees, once again, the Pharisees kind of represent the status quo, the elite of the culture of Jerusalem. He is telling that in chapter 11, he's telling the Pharisees, he's accusing them of hypocrisy. He says, "You Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness." And he goes on to chastise them and elaborate on that a little bit. And at the beginning of chapter 12, the crowds have gathered. Luke says by the thousands, the crowds have gathered. And the first thing he says to them is don't be like the Pharisees. Okay, so in chapter 11, Jesus is chastising them for their greed and their wickedness. So the crowd gathers by the thousands. He tells them, don't be like these that I've just chastised. Okay? Then he says this, he says, faith in me is not going to lead to comfort and to prestige and to wealth. He says, faith in me is not going to lead to those things. These are things that the Pharisees has. Don't be like the Pharisees. As a matter of fact, you believe in me, you will not be like the Pharisees. You will not be wealthy. You will not be famous. You will not be well thought of. As a matter of fact, he says, you'll be persecuted. You'll be taken before the synagogues and you will be held in contempt. You will be put on trial. And then he says this. He says, when they bring you before the synagogues, the rulers and authority and the authorities, do not worry about how you are to defend yourself or what you are to say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you at that very hour what to say. So here's this phenomenal description of faith in Jesus as being something that's not going to lead to wealth and comfort. But don't worry, because the Holy Spirit will be with you. All right. The very next verse, okay. Someone in the crowd, okay, there's thousands of people. Someone in the crowd says, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." Man, so something has been keeping this person from understanding what Jesus is talking about. He said, you know, faith in me is not going to result in wealth and comfort. Don't mean to interrupt, but would you mind telling my brother to give me wealth and comfort? Would that be so? Because we want, you see that nothing could be clearer, that something is keeping this person from understanding what Jesus is telling him. Jesus then immediately says three things that really confront me. First thing he says, I'm going to skip over that one there because I've already talked about it. First thing he says is, beware of all kinds of greed. All right, here's a great picture of what we usually think of as greed. When Jesus confronts the Pharisees, he says, "You're full of greed and wickedness," and we think of this, right? So this over-the-top sort of greed, this sort of consumption, this exaggerated sort of consumption without limits, you know, and never being satisfied and always wanting more. But I want to suggest to you that's one kind of greed, the kind of greed that we typically think of when we talk about greedy people. But he says, beware of all kinds of greed. I wonder if there is another kind of greed. And I began, as I reflected on this, I thought to myself, I wonder if I might be afflicted with a very comfortable, a very subtle sort of greed. Jesus says another thing. The second thing Jesus says that confronts me, it follows on my questions. Yeah, I wonder if I might be... how might I know if I have this comfortable sort of greed that I don't really perceive, I don't really understand? He says this. He says, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Wow. I'm thinking, that's not me. Whew. Yeah, I don't have a lot of stuff. And then I began to think about it. I go, well, wait a minute. I've got it. All you have to do is like look in my garage, okay? And you will see an abundance of possessions. I got so much stuff in there, it all won't fit on the floor. I've got stuff hanging from the ceiling, you know, in my garage. An abundance of possessions that, guess what? I'm going to say, okay, if you took all of it, okay, if you looked at the closets, okay, stuffed so much that clothes barely fit in there. Okay, if you look at my home office area that is kind of our catch-all for all the stuff that we don't have room for in the garage or the closets, right? Okay, so none of you can relate to this, I know. Okay, but if you take a look at all that stuff, you put it all together, I would say easily 50% of that doesn't get used. Why do I keep it? I can identify with Pepper the cat, right? It's like, hey, but if I got rid of it, I simply wouldn't have it anymore. And then Jesus says a third thing that brings this confrontation in my own heart to a head. He tells a parable. And many of you know, I'm contemplating, Martha and I are looking forward to retirement in a couple of years, okay? So don't start celebrating right away. But it's something that's going to happen in a couple of years, you know, Lord willing. And this parable is about retirement. This parable is about a phenomenal luxury. It's something that we take for granted, okay? It's part of our understanding of the way things that work. But in the first century, retirement was a phenomenal luxury that only occurred for the extremely wealthy. Jesus tells this parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, what should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said this, I will do this. I'll pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. Isn't that kind of the mindset of retirement? That's kind of the mindset of retirement. You know, we store up our goods in storehouses. What are our storehouses? Okay, we have storehouses for like physical stuff, right? When I figure that when the garage fills up and the closets and the home office, okay, when I move, okay, if I don't have space for all that stuff when I retire, right, I can always put it in the storage place, right? So there are my storehouses, right, for all my stuff that I don't have room for. But one of these days I might need them, right? I know none of you can relate to this. I shouldn't really even mention it, but what are our storehouses for the kind of the intangible sort of stuff, right? What are our storehouses? The 401ks, right? Our IRAs, our pension funds, even Social Security, what are those things? Wow. It's getting warm in here for anybody but me. God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves but are not rich toward God. Man. Now, again, this really confronts me. The only thing that gives me a little bit of refuge, a little bit of relief here, at least a small shadow to hide under, is Jesus says, "For so it will be for those who store up treasures for themselves but are not rich toward God." You know, it's the implication is there, okay, that if I store up things for myself, treasures, okay, perhaps it's okay as long as I am rich toward God. So that begs the question, what does it mean to be rich toward God? Okay, now here's the place where the preacher with any common sense at all and a good treasurer, you know, to root him on, would say it means giving till it hurts. Okay, so there you go. I was reading in today's discipline the disciplines commentary book that the Upper Room puts out. It's not the Upper Room devotional book. There's another one. It's a little bit more detailed. It's called the Disciplines. Daily Disciplines. That's what it's called. Daily Disciplines. I was reading it, and it said that to be rich toward God is to be generous toward God. And I think that is a that is something that you could get out of this if you just take the parable all by itself. But there's a lot more that comes next. There is a lot more that comes next. To be rich toward God, to have treasures, is to be dependent upon God. And so it goes more than simply being generous. I believe it means to be dependent upon God, to know that we're dependent upon God, and to be glad that we are dependent of God, and to be free within that dependence. And the reason I say all that is that there is another verse. Okay, look at verse 21. Says, so it is with those who store up treasures for themselves but are not rich toward God. Now then, if we look at verse 34, I began to, because it begs the question, what does it mean to be rich toward God? You can't You can't just like stop right there. You've got to say, okay, what does that mean? What would Jesus want us to know? What would Luke want us to know about what it is to be rich toward God? And so I read further, and I read further, and I read further, and I read further, and finally, I come to verse 34. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now, the word treasure is key here. Store up treasures for themselves, and then where your treasure is. So those two words, treasure, come together in a very clear, a very clear way. So we have to know, as we study Scripture, as we do Bible study, as we study Scripture, we have to realize that when words come together like that, we need to look in between those two words and see what is there. And what is there is this description Jesus gives that crowd of thousands of people. This description he gives them of what it means to be rich toward God. The first thing he says is, therefore I tell you. That word therefore connects it with what came before, right? He says that's the way it is for those who store up treasures for themselves but are not rich toward God. Therefore, okay. All right, now he's telling us, this is connected. Do not worry about your life, what you will eat, about your body, what you will wear. Okay, now I'm not challenged by that. I don't worry about what I'm going to eat. As you can tell, I'm doing pretty good. All right, I don't worry about what I'm going to wear. But in the day of Jesus, those were things that people worried about. Life was hard, and life was an almost unceasing quest to be fed and to be clothed and to be sheltered. And Jesus said, don't worry about these basics, okay? So let me ask, what are we worried? You know, what are the things that cause us anxiety? I said that there was something on the person's mind who asked him the question, because the question counteracts exactly what Jesus told them. And he says, okay, so tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. And I said, there's something obviously on this man's mind that has kept him from understanding what Jesus was talking about. He was worried about something. What are the things that worry us? The young man was worried about the inheritance. None of us can relate to that, can we? Right? That hasn't happened in our lives, in our families? No. But what you will eat, about what you will wear, what are the things that worry us these days? How are those 401ks going these days? Okay, not good, no. For the very first time, this is a true story, very first time, I promise, that I've ever thought that to actually look at the retirement calculator thing for my pension fund, right? So about a month or two ago, I got on there and I looked, and it said my retirement had gone down 15%. I'm going, well, that can't be good. What are the things that we worry about these days? Do we worry about what we will eat, what we will wear, or maybe a better way to say it, as Nancy asked Pepper, the cat, how will you know when you've had enough? How will you know when you have enough yarn? How will we know when we have enough? And I began to think that perhaps we worry about having enough. And I know I'm preaching to the choir here, because I know I'm only anticipating retirement. Many of us are already retired. What was the thing that your financial advisor always preached to you, right? You've got to make sure you have enough. You got to make sure you have enough. And the one thing that they would always ask you, no, they would always tell you, at least the financial advisors that have always talked to me, they would always tell you how much was enough, right? And in this, Jesus says, don't worry about what you'll eat, what you'll wear. And I think that Jesus is asking us simply to ponder the question, how much is enough? And some of us are much younger than retirement age. And I think that it's important for us to ponder that as well as we look at the things that cause us concern. But, you know, am I going to be able to make the car payment? Am I going to be able to make the house payment? Am I going to be able to you know, do those things? How much, really, how much is enough? Jesus says this, for life is more than food and the body more than clothes. The very next thing he says, do we know what life is? You know, he doesn't say life is about more than food and life is about more than you know, he doesn't talk about what life is about. He talks about the very substance of life itself. The very substance of life itself. What is life? Okay, now that is deep. The superficial answer, if someone said, who are you? Well, you say, well, you give your name, right? I'm Tony, right? And you say, I am this. You typically would say your name, you say your vocation, right? And if you're retired, what you say, I'm a retired, you know, whatever, I'm a retired preacher, I'm a retired school teacher, I'm a retired law enforcement, I'm a retired military. Or you'd say, well, I work for the schools, you know, I work for the city, I work for a plumber, I work for an electrician, you know, whatever it might be. You say our name, our vocation. We might say where we live, because that's important to us. We might, you know, but if pressed, then if we ask more and more of what, you know, who are you? Oh, wow. What is life? Jesus seems to be saying your life is more than all those things. And then he begins to say this. I love this image of the ravens. Consider the ravens, verse 24. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor they reap. And ravens are a particular sort of bird. They tend to take whatever they find, right? And so Jesus is saying, this is interesting. It's nice that he uses ravens, right? Because, you know, you think of robins, you know, getting up early and being industrious, you know, and going hunting and, you know, and gathering and foraging. You know, not so much with ravens. You think of ravens as just this bird of opportunity that just kind of comes along, lights somewhere, takes whatever is provided, I guess you'd say, and flies off. Man. He says, they neither sow nor they reap, they neither have storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. And then he says this, of how much more value are you than the birds? Do we know how valuable we are? You know, the testimony of Scripture from the book of Genesis in the very beginning, God made us in God's image and gave us dominion over all things. From the very beginning in the book of Genesis, we see that there's something special about humanity. There's something powerful here. And the psalmist declares that God declares that we are like the gods. And in John's gospel, Jesus actually says, you know, when he is confronted about claiming to be the Son of God, Jesus says, don't your own scriptures say, I tell you, you are gods? Man. You know, the testimony of Scripture from the Old Testament through the Psalms to the Gospels, you know, tell us there's something special about us. Do we know how valuable we are? And can we trust that? Do we know that God will provide? And if we do know that God will provide, can we trust that? And oh, here's the tough part. Will we be happy with that? Or do we think that we can do a better job than God can? You know, God taught me a long time ago that if I thought I could do a better job than God, that God would be happy to let me try it out, you know? And it never has worked out that great. Do we know how valuable we are? Yeah. Finally, Jesus says once again, he ends this description of what it means to be rich toward God by once again saying, don't worry. I love this. He says, can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? Man. That worry doesn't help things, does it? It doesn't help us help physically, does it? As a matter of fact, worry shortens our span of life. Worry shortens our span of life. Anxiety shortens our lifespan. I had a heart attack in 2001 at the age of 44. I said, Doc, what caused me to have a heart attack? He says, you need a vacation, son. There's hardly any blockage there at all. You're just stressed out. I took the source of my stress on vacation with me, but that's another story. It wasn't Martha. It was our two daughters, okay? I tell this, they had just become teenagers and preteens, and World War III had broken out, okay? And I thought it was my job to be the referee and to make things right, okay? But anxiety, worry shortens our lives. It doesn't lengthen our lives. It's not beneficial at all. And you know, the worst thing is about worry is that it kills relationships, doesn't it? Anxiety comes between us and our relatives. Anxiety comes between us and our friends, and our acquaintances. Anxiety comes between us and God. Why couldn't the young man, I assume he's a young man, who wanted his brother to divide the family inheritance with him, why couldn't he hear what Jesus was saying? I believe it's because his mind was occupied with other things. He was anxious about other things. Jesus says over and over again, don't worry. Worry kills. Worry kills our bodies. Worry kills our relationships. Worry kills our relationships most of all with God. And then he says this. Trust this. He says, don't worry. Don't be afraid. Don't be anxious, because it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. The kingdom of God. Now, that's what this has been about all this time, is this treasure that's in our hearts, this treasure that we're storing up, this treasure is the kingdom of God. He said, it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom of God. And you know, in Luke's gospel, Luke is very focused on the kingdom of God. And Luke is adamant. You know, the Jesus that is presented in Luke's gospel is adamant that the kingdom of God is a here and now reality. It's not some pie in the sky promise. You know, it's not some ivory tower thing that we think about. It's a present here and now reality. In all the other gospels, you see Jesus saying, the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God is at hand. In Luke's gospel, you see Jesus saying, the kingdom of God is among you. The kingdom of God is within you. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you that kingdom. Yeah. And that's what it's been about. That's what this treasure is. He says this as we conclude. He says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Yeah. I want my heart to be in the here and now kingdom of God. And I want that to be where my treasure is as well. You know, I mentioned in the first service that you know, there's not a big so what at the end of this sermon. And I've got, you know, there's not a big so what. Any, you know, a really good preacher would say, okay, so now the moral of this story is give till it hurts. I'm not going to say that, okay? I've said that three times already, haven't I? Okay, no, the so what here, you know, there's not a big so what. But, you know, the thing is, this is the sort of thing that we don't talk about very much, is it? You know, the real down-to-earth anxiety and the nitty-gritty worrying that we do, and the fights that break out within families about this very sort of thing. You know, it's not the sort of thing that we talk about very often. But I feel like there's at least one or two of us here in this congregation that this speaks to. And I pray that there is there's a peace and an assurance and a freedom that comes with God's Spirit ministering to us in this moment. Let's pray. Mighty God, give us your peace, for without your assurance, for without your blessing, we cannot be free from worry. In this moment, we put our trust in you. Bless us, O mighty God. Bless us with the blessing of treasure that is in the kingdom of God, that we might be there as well. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. All right, well, our closing hymn today is Here I Am, Lord. It's number 593 in that big hymnal. And once again, I invite you to stand, become one together as we sing Here I Am, Lord. Okay, just a few reminders today as we venture forth. Let's see, flowers today are in gratitude of God's amazing grace. All right. Our United Women in Faith craft team, they meet tomorrow, 9:30 to noon. Come get crafty and get ready for the Harvest Festival, Harvest Fair. Our staff parish relations committee, if you're on that team, be sure and be here tomorrow at 5 p.m. I'm sorry, Wednesday, 5 p.m. Thank you. Boy, getting ahead of myself, aren't I? Okay, our United Women in Faith, they are celebrating the end of summer, but they also are kicking off the beginning of their new fall season. And there is a sign-up sheet if you'd like to attend. It's a lot of fun. They've got a few things planned. I'm not sure I can tell you about them. It's a surprise. Come and be surprised. Our district men's retreat, Great Northern District, is having a men's retreat. There are some forms in the foyer to pick up if you'd like to register for that. I'm going to be going on the 18th because I need the relaxed day. You know, I have a penchant for hammocks and napping chairs. Okay. Let's receive our benediction. May the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever as we go in peace. Amen.